Well, seeking the help of the Lord, let's turn in his word to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we'll take our text for today in the words of verse 4. First Peter chapter 1, and reading again at verse 4. We could read from verse 3 to set the words in context. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. And especially these words, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Well, friends, does the gospel not produce hope? Is it not our experience that believing in Jesus brings forth hope in our lives? That indeed it brings forth this living hope, which we have described and set forth for us in verse 3 of this chapter, and now expounded and explained in more detail. A living hope, I believe, in the same manner in which we speak in Scripture of living water. That is a hope that is always fresh, that is always new, that is always abundant. This living hope is a hope of an inheritance. And it is a hope that God's abundant mercy has begotten us unto. So it is a hope that arises from his work of adoption. Because we are the children of God, therefore we have a hope. And if we wanted to sum up the doctrine of this text that is before us, we could say that the children of God have a hope laid up in store for them, which brings us in this world to worship and to the pursuit of godliness. A hope indeed so glorious that it produces worship and godliness. And it would therefore be profitable for us to spend a few minutes this night reflecting upon the living hope of the children of God. And as we reach our final prayer meeting of the year, what could be a more appropriate subject to lift our thoughts above the circumstances of this life into eternity, into the hope of heaven? Peter, you know, was writing here to believers in the midst of truly dark circumstances. Believers experiencing real danger, physical persecution from ruthless Roman authorities and from Jewish communities which perceived the Christian converts as apostates and as traitors to their nation. Facing persecution on all sides, Peter exhorted them to comfort in that hope laid up in store. That hope of which the Apostle Paul was speaking in the passage we read, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 18, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. So we see that this is a worthy subject for our attention this night. 3 points, as the Lord will enable us. We'll consider firstly the substance of the hope. Secondly, we'll consider the character of the hope. and thirdly, the promise of that hope. So firstly then, the substance of the hope. We are begotten again to an inheritance. A word that of course carries all the significance of adoption and of the children of God in it. There is an inheritance for the children of God because we are his, and that inheritance awaits us. And therefore it is a proper subject for us to consider most solemnly. Robert Leighton, the great covenanting commentator, describes it by way of an illustration. He speaks of the heir as a child, growing up first in the immaturity of young childhood, seeing the wonder of the great estate that is awaiting him and looking upon it with childlike delight. But as the child grows into a young man, as maturation occurs, so the responsibility of the estate becomes very real. The contemplation of the estate becomes more intelligent. The solemnity of it weighs more heavily, but therefore the delight in it becomes not less, but all the greater, because the full scale and scope and value and worth is discerned by maturity. And so as believers, it is the province of maturing faith to look more deeply and to reflect more profoundly on the inheritance that is laid up in store for us. What is this inheritance that is described for us? We're told in verse 3 that it is a lively hope, a living hope that is, to which we are begotten by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So it is a hope that is secured for us by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But of course, it's more than that, isn't it? Christ himself is the hope. Christ himself is the inheritance. We can prove that from the Old Testament reading that we took from Psalm 16. It's more familiar to us, of course, in the metrical version. God is of mine inheritance and cup the portion. And isn't it an awesome thought to consider that all the privileges and blessings and benefits of the Christian hope and of heaven that are to come, they are all bound up in Christ. The risen Christ. It is him who has purchased them. It is him who has promised them. It is him who grants them. They are tasted and enjoyed in Christ. So what is that hope then? The substance of the hope, an inheritance. It's a moral inheritance, isn't it? Conformity with Christ. In that day we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Like him, not in the grandeur which he enjoys, at the pinnacle of heaven and enjoying its praise, but like him in the moral respect, like him in his godliness. To be conformed to the image of his Son. That's our longing here, begotten by the Spirit of God, no praise to us. That's our longing here, if we are his. And therefore that is the fulfillment in heaven itself. Conformity to Christ. To be like him. In other words, not merely as in verse 3, to have the status of sons, to be those who are, as we read, begotten again unto a lively hope, but to have the hope, to have not merely the status of sons, but the character of sons, to be the children of God, to be fit brothers and sisters of Christ. If children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ. And in heaven, there's nothing incongruous in that. For in heaven we are like him. Is that not a glorious prospect? Is that not sweet to you to imagine likeness to Christ in a mind purged of selfishness, in a body purged of all these vile emotions of anger and lust and jealousy that so dominate our conduct, a tongue made clean, purified from the swear words and the lies and the gossip of this world, and made rather an instrument of the worship of God continually. Think of conformity to Christ, and you think of an inheritance that is beautiful and precious, and all the more beautiful and precious as you grow in the knowledge of the Saviour. More conformity to Christ, but also communion with Christ. This living hope from the resurrection of Jesus Christ is not just to be like him, but it is to be with him. It is to be his bride. It is to be joined and united to him, world without end. Consider the substance of this hope. The Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them and lead them to the fountains of living water. That he himself will be our companion, our shepherd, our guide, our master, our companion, our friend for all eternity. Is that not a beautiful thing? Friendship is a beautiful thing. We love the companionship of those who are like-minded, when we have shared interests and shared priorities. Marriage, above all, is a precious, precious thing and brings people into a closer and more intimate union and a closer and more intimate conformity than any other human relationship in this world. But even human marriage, it is but temporary. It is but for a time. It is but a type of the eternal communion, companionship with the blessed Saviour. Oh, consider the hope that lies in store for the children of God, to be his family. Is that not beautiful? And is it not more beautiful as you grow in the knowledge of him? And yet even that doesn't exhaust it, because consider the comfort that arises from that. Conformity, communion, comfort in Christ. He shall wipe every tear from their eyes. Isn't it not beautiful to think that all of the unrequited longings which we have in this world, all the desires which never can be satisfied, and in many cases never should and must never be satisfied, that all of that will be gone, that in eternity our desires will be for what is attainable to us. Our longing, our soul longing, will be to give glory to God, to give honour to Christ, to exalt the author of our salvation, and to delight in him forever. And that will be attainable. You see, the beauty of the inheritance is that we are granted the capacity to do what we wish. You know, that's what people desire so much, the riches of this world. Think if I won the national lottery, I'd be able to spend money on whatever I wish. And yet, they go around those who have won the lottery and they ask them if it made them happier. And in many a case, it's rather, it broke apart all my relationships, destroyed all my friendships, rent my marriage in two, and in some cases, left me penniless because I spent it all, and now it's all gone. But oh, friends, there's riches that satisfy. Isn't that beautiful to think of? Riches that satisfy our every desire, and that's the comfort that awaits in heaven. An inheritance. That's the inheritance of the child of God. Oh, friend, consider the risen Christ. It's all in him. Grow in the knowledge of Christ, and you will only grow in your longing, your hunger for this inheritance. He is beautiful, and his reward is with him. Dear friends, do we love his appearing? It's one of the marks of the Lord's people. They long for Christ's coming, and they love the thought of his presence. Is it so with you this night? Does this inheritance call to you and call forth your desire? The substance of the inheritance. Secondly, the character of the inheritance. Incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away. Three negatives. The fact they're negatives is highly significant. Incorruptible, undefiled, that fadeth not away. It underlines that our minds in this world have so little capacity to truly reflect upon the glory of Christ, that really we're reduced to speaking of it more in terms of what it is not than what it is. We can understand what it is not. And so it is expressed in these ways. The full positive understanding of the beauty and glory of Christ, well, that remains. That abides. That's the experience that awaits in heaven itself. But here we must speak by way of negative. And so Scripture tells us that he is an inheritance incorruptible. The word seems to convey the notion of corruption from without. The word that is negatived here is used in the Greek version of Isaiah 24 to describe the ravages, the invasions brought upon the land of Israel by foreign enemies. Those coming in from without, attacking the land, bringing in their vile corruption. The Midianites coming and stealing the grain of the people. The Babylonians coming and demolishing the walls of Jerusalem and burning the temple to the ground. At last, the Romans coming and carrying away the Jews into their exile of 2,000 years. Enemies from without bringing corruption. So it is with riches in this world. We all know that, don't we? If we have possessions, we have to guard them, keep them safe. We need locks. We need doors. We need gates. We need bars to guard and keep these riches. Go to the museums and you see everywhere the security staff. You see these cases that cannot be broken into. You see the alarm systems. All these things that point to a fallen world. A world where treasure is impermanent. Where there is a danger. Where there is that corruption that can carry it off and remove it. But oh, think of heaven. There is beauty that cannot be taken. There is glory that is truly incorruptible. Who can invade heaven? Who can enter the city of the Lamb without his will? There shall in no wise enter it anything that maketh a lie or that worketh abomination. It is his city. He reigns over it. And though he has many enemies, yet they are powerless before Christ. That inheritance abides incorruptible. Its permanence is absolute. It is undefiled. Now that would seem to bring us to what is within, to the spot and the stain which in this world mars every good thing. The defilement of the land of Israel, even itself, defiled from within by a sinful people who put their idols upon every high hill and under every green tree, defiling my inheritance, says the Lord. But oh, in heaven there's no defilement. The Lamb is without blemish and without spot. It's an awesome truth. You know, in this world, there is always that blemish to something that is good. You know, you see a beautiful meal table set before you with lovely food, the freshest food, cooked to the best, to the perfect consistency and temperature. All is good, all is nutritious, all is appetizing. But leave the table, go away for a week and come back. Is it appetizing then, covered with mold, bringing forth corruption? The blemish was within. It was within the food. The seeds were there, and they've grown, and they've brought forth the foul, ugly bacteria. The meal is ruined. It is inedible. It's unfit for animals. It's but for the dustbin. No blemish in heaven. No blemish. No matter how long we linger here in this world, yet heaven is not defiled. It is not corrupted. There is no seed of iniquity or of ugliness growing there. Rather, its perfection is only the more beautiful the more we grow in the knowledge of it and of Him. The more we contemplate Christ, the more we contemplate eternity, the more we long for it. Incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away. Here is perhaps the saddest truth of all about human riches. They lose their luster. Same car. Its first year of life, well, it's sold by the shiny dealership for a very expensive sum per month. Same car. A couple of years later, oh, it's now, it's the back street, the second-hand car dealership being sold and at a much more modest price. Same car. A couple of years later still, and it just got a notice taped in the window parked at the side of the road for, in car terms, small change. Same car, but it's lost its luster. Few years of use, and no longer does it attract. But, you know, think of Christ. He doesn't lose his luster. The more you see of Him, the more you know of Him, the more you love Him, the more you desire Him, the more you hunger for Him, the more you see of His attributes, the more beautiful He is, the more you see of His work, the more perfect it is. And He will continue like that. You know, you all have pictures on the walls of your homes. You chose them, as we did, because you like the pictures. When did you last look at them? You know, we like the pictures, we like that they're there. But in many respects, they've lost their luster. We can probably hardly remember the last time we looked at them, if we're honest. They're just there. They no longer have any particular visual interest. We've known them, we've seen them. That's it, they're there. But oh, with Christ, there's always more to discover, more depths, because He is infinite. Isn't that an awesome thing? An infinite Saviour of infinite beauty, and it will be the work of eternity to sing His praise. He is an inheritance that fadeth not away, and He is reserved in heaven for you. Think of that, reserved. Literally, in the original language, kept. Kept for you. Kept by God, by His solemn word of promise, by His gracious provision, by His covenant, kept. That Saviour is reserved. No one will take Him from you. No one can. You cannot corrupt Him by your sin. You cannot defile His heaven. And you cannot lose Him if He is yours. Reserved in heaven for you. Oh, lift your eyes to the perfections of Christ. We see much of our own imperfections, and we should and we must, but see the perfections of Christ, and you see the answer that you need. And that then brings us thirdly to consider the promise of this hope. We've seen the substance, we've seen the character, the promise reserved in heaven for you. So who is this inheritance reserved for? Who are the beneficiaries who will enjoy such blessedness? How can we sum them up? How can we describe their character? Those who need him. Surely God's people need their Saviour. Those who do not merely admire him, who do not merely respect him, who do not merely honour him outwardly and with words, those who know, I must have this man to be my Saviour. Without him, I am lost and without hope. I need him. That's the attitude of the believer to Christ. That is true faith. It is an absolute commitment to him. It is a definitive thing. It is the difference between believer and unbeliever, between the one who rests upon Christ and the one who does not. Believer needs him. This inheritance, it's not merely attractive and desirable, it's essential. If you do not have this, then your whole life has been a waste. You have squandered your time. It would have been better for you if you had never been born. Do you think like that? That's the thought life of the child of God. They would rather not have been born than have missed out on Christ. He is necessary to them. In Pilgrim's Progress, Bunyan describes how Christian was challenged by Obstinate, his neighbour who came pursuing after him as he began his journey towards the celestial city. And Obstinate says to him, how can you leave behind your friends and your neighbours and your companions and your pleasures to go seeking this celestial city? And it's in this text that Christian answers him. I go, he says, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for me. He finds in the word of God his answer to temptation, and that is always the experience of Christian. Christian, in our experience, as we answer the tempter with the word of truth, this inheritance, we must have it. We must have it. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. We must have it. We hunger for it. Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. We need it, but we also want it. God's people want to be holy. They want to have Christ beside them. They want to have heaven, not for streets paved with gold, not for eternity of conscious life, not for safety from the fires. They want heaven because they want to be holy and because they want Christ. Oh, friend, do you hunger to be like him? Do you thirst for more of Jesus Christ? This is the child of God. This is the mark of the hope of heaven, to have a hunger, an appetite, and a desire for more. There is a beginning of heaven here. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Faith makes heaven real in the experience of the believer. By faith we know Christ. By faith we taste Christ. But we want more. That's the experience of the child of God. And we love him. We love Christ above all, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Dear friend, is the beauty of this inheritance that Christ is the heart of it? Is the value of it summed up in this, that he is the light in the midst of that city? That there is no sun, that there is no moon, that there is Christ. Does he have that character for you? That he, the Lamb, is all the glory in Emmanuel's land, and that that draws you. Oh, may it be so, friends, may it be so. May it be that we find ourselves in that. And if we find these marks burning low, then let us feed these marks in the only way that they can be fed, with the contemplation of Christ. Let me urge you, friends, pursue an appetite for heaven. An appetite for heaven is good. This is the hope that Peter sets before troubled believers in dark times, and in our own, granted, more modest dark times, in our own relatively lighter and easier trials, though we may still feel them hard and painful in the experience. Oh, let us be found looking up with that hunger, that desire, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Looking up, for our redemption draweth near. Looking up, for he comes soon. Looking up, because up above is all our hope. I to the hills will lift mine eyes. From whence doth come mine aid? Oh, we have a glorious inheritance. We have a blessed privilege as the children of God. Let's remember then, Christ our comfort, the hope of heaven, and the joys of this eternal world. Let me leave you with a quote from John Bunyan. He remarks, "All the things in the world will not fill one heart, and yet one thought of heaven for the child of God will fill that heart to overflowing." One thought of heaven. Oh, may it be so for you and me. Amen. Let's come before the Lord in prayer. Holy Lord God, we do honour and bless thy mighty name for all that thou art. We honour thee for the inheritance of heaven. We bless thee for the hope that is laid up in store for the child of God. And truly our heart is there, for our treasure is there, because our Saviour is there. And we love him because he first loved us. O Lord, we commit our ways to thee. At the end of this sad and trying year, a year full of loss, full of pain, full of grief, full of perplexity, yet in it all, yet we look up, yet we find hope, and our comfort is above. O grant that we might be found looking up even unto the end, as those whose hope, as those whose place is to be by thy side forever. Pardon our sins. Love us freely. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. Let us conclude. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.